Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming to another of our meetings here. This time, we are it's a great pleasure and privilege for us at the center to have His Royal Highness Prince Turki Al-Faisal bin Abdulaziz Al-Saud to speak for us. I really don't want to say much about because I think that you might have read, those of you who got the invitation, his bio. All I can say that I have seen him in many other conferences as well. He's not only great statesman, but he's also a scholar and a great person that knows all the intricacies of international relations and affairs. As I say, I had the privilege of being in a couple of conferences with him, and I have seen him perform firsthand. So I think that we have a really great treat today. His Highness will speak on the topic of yes to Palestine. Then we will have a question and answer period. Let me just urge you that when you, first of all, please ask questions. Don't make too long comments, if I may be so bold as to request that. The other thing is that we would appreciate it if you could identify yourself and your affiliation so that for our future contacts and so on. So without further ado, I'll ask His Royal Highness to
talk
to us. And please get put.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, for giving me the privilege to speak to you. Secondly, for being there. After such a setup, I hope I don't disappoint you. On Friday, September 23rd, 2011, Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas stood before the United Nations General Assembly and declared that the time has come for Palestinians to have their own state. Abbas quoted the great poet Mahmoud Darwish, who expressed his longing for a home by proclaiming, and I quote, "Standing here, staying here, permanent here, eternal here, and we have one goal, one and only one, to be." Upon hearing these words, who could honestly refuse the Palestinian people what they seek and what everyone deserves, a place to truly be? Just think how important it is to each of us to have a place we call home. In politics and for a nation, that place is called a state. And emotionally, it feels like a home. There is no sleep, no harvest, no love, no family, no tomorrow without it. We should never take a home for granted. And put yourselves in the shoes of a people who were stripped of a home, and in many cases of their actual physical homes, many decades ago. We should all be grateful for what we have, but we also have a duty to help those less fortunate than us to enjoy the same rights and achieve the same goal. On Friday, September 23rd, 2011, marks the turning point when Palestinians decided to take matters into their own hands, finally convincing the world of their inherent right for a state and a home. Not only have they been homeless for decades, but they have been besieged, humiliated, and oppressed by a ruthless occupier. They have been led down dead-end streets, sometimes by their own, but most of all by their Israeli occupiers, who alternated violent repression with periods of keeping Palestinians engaged in meaningless negotiations, only to steal more of their land and build yet more colonies to create what they call facts on the ground. All of this was unfortunately legitimized by the United States and its international partners when they failed to halt or punish Israel for the violation of countless UN Security Council resolutions and principles of international law covering occupation and the right to self-determination. Before this injustice lays the historical failure that of the two states provided for in the United Nations Partition Plan, Resolution 181, only one, Israel, was ever established. This represents more than 60 years of deceit and injury, by the international community. The West Bank and Gaza, the 22% of historic Palestine that Palestinians hope soon to call their home, has been occupied for almost 45 years, since before Richard Nixon became President of the United States. How are an occupied people to stand on equal footing at the negotiating table when the other side has made it clear that they do not recognize their claim to a home? How can such a people receive what is rightfully theirs if the main peace broker sides unfailingly with its Israeli protege? Only an internationally recognized Palestine can require Israel to respect its obligations and enter into serious negotiations. As a respected and trusted leader in the Arab world, Saudi Arabia cannot stand by as their Palestinian brothers are mistreated and humiliated, deprived of their intrinsic rights as human beings. Neither we nor the rest of the world can tolerate this situation. Arabs are united behind the cause of the Palestinian people because it is a historic calamity that they have seen fester for too long. It is our responsibility to help the Palestinian people achieve the basic right of statehood and freedom from the unrestricted and intolerable occupation imposed upon them by the Israelis. As former U.S. President Jimmy Carter recently said, and I quote, "The persecution of the Palestinians under the occupation forces is one of the worst examples of human rights deprivation." This year has been marked in the Arab world by the actions of ordinary Arabs claiming their rights to a say in how they are governed, to be listened to, and to seek a better future for their children. It is a right the Palestinian people have been seeking for decades, yet they do not even have their own state. Their situation has only become more desperate over the years. It is our duty as human beings, Arabs and Americans alike, to support the Palestinian bid for statehood. Over the past decade, some momentous changes have swept through the Arab world. Ordinary Arabs have been brought together through modern technology, satellite news, and instant communication. Old preconceptions have been challenged, and their great potential has become clearer to them. The shock of 9/11 brought us to question the basis of our societies, strengthening new currents of tolerance and interaction. President Obama astutely noted these changes at a time when the United States was embroiled in painful conflicts in the Middle East. He chose to address the Arabs directly in his June 2009 Cairo speech in a bid for a fresh start and a new partnership between the Arab world and the United States. We all wish this fresh start had borne fruit, but for a host of reasons, it did not. By asking for support for a Palestinian state, Arabs are hoping to revive the kind of partnership that President Obama envisaged. This is an opportunity for Americans to rescue their credibility that has been so damaged by the conflicts America has been involved in and its unwillingness to stand up to endless Israeli violations of international law, human rights, and human decency. The consequences of that policy have proved greatly injurious. The hands of irrational extremists, whether in Iran, in Syria, or anywhere, were significantly strengthened. Ultimately, the security of the entire Middle East, including Israel, has been endangered. It is only due to the actions of ordinary Arabs that the tables are finally beginning to turn in the region, an opportunity that America cannot afford to pass over. Unwavering U.S. support for Israel has also created domestic political problems that may have been somewhat set aside in this time of economic crisis, but sooner or later will rear their head again. Most importantly, what America risks by ignoring the Palestinian right to self-determination and statehood is losing the goodwill of an entire region, its people and government. Because America cannot support justice for the Palestinian people, after all the speeches it has made in support of the so-called Arab Spring, Arabs have concluded that America never sought to be a fair arbiter. The danger is to see the severing of important relationships like the special relationship America enjoys with the regional power that is Saudi Arabia. Until now, our countries have cooperated closely on issues of energy, security, terrorism, and regional conflicts. If our paths diverge on the issue of Palestinian statehood, they will likely also diverge on other regional issues. And without that goodwill and coordination, it is a situation from which both of us will suffer. Saudi Arabia, if it cannot count on America's sincere cooperation and sense of justice, will have to act more assertively and independently on issues ranging from Iraq to Iran, from energy to Gulf security. This is a path for which none of us wish. The strongest argument I can give you, ladies and gentlemen, is that a true partnership between the United States and the Arab world has become all the more essential in the world we live in today. Arabs rightfully feel that America's involvement in the region has been either an attempt to impose their own way and ideas or ignoring a situation entirely. America's reaction to the so-called Arab Spring has only reinforced that impression. Instead of this damaging dichotomy, we would like to see America become a true partner to the Arab world. To become a true partner, America must understand that past approaches have failed, that it is time to try something new, that Palestinians must finally be granted what has always been their right, namely a state they can call their own and one in which they can finally negotiate on equal footing with their occupying Israeli counterparts. True friendship, ladies and gentlemen, requires one to say not what your friend wants to hear, but what is true, even if it hurts his feelings. Indeed, some of you, ladies and gentlemen, might feel hurt when I say that America has not stood up for the basic human rights of the Palestinian people. You might feel hurt when I say that America has been unreliable in preventing gross Israeli violations of Palestinian rights and international law. By the same token, the United States will be a truer friend to Israel if it supports Palestinians in their bid for statehood and equal footing in negotiations with Israel. For the sooner a fair peace agreement is reached, the more effectively Israel's security can be ensured. The dividends of peace for Israel will be those spelled out in King Abdullah's 2002 Arab Peace Initiative, namely, full peace and fully normalized relations with all Arab countries, all Muslim countries, allowing the region to prosper in security and stability and ostracizing extremist powers. Recent polls have shown that 70% of Palestinians believe if the current deadlock is not broken shortly, there will be a new intifada. Such an outcome would be immensely costly to everyone involved. The only sensible course of action is for Israel to negotiate on equal footing with Palestinian leader Mahmoud Abbas as representative of a Palestinian state. The first pillar of that negotiation obviously entails a Palestinian party on equal footing with the Israelis. That is to say, through the international recognition of Palestinian statehood. This entails legal rights and obligations that Israel has until now chosen to ignore. And that is why Israel has fought the idea of Palestinian statehood through the United Nations so vehemently. Second, a greater role in future negotiations must be played by Saudi Arabia, moderate Arab countries, and the Europeans. In order to advance a solution, America and Saudi Arabia must each play the role of mediator and guarantor of negotiations, exercising their influence on Palestinians and Israelis respectively to reach agreement. Israeli officials recently admitted privately to their European counterparts that only Saudi Arabia, which has earmarked over $2.5 billion in aid to the Palestinian Authority and other Palestinian institutions since June 2009, making it the largest supporter, will be able to give the Palestinians the required religious, political, and financial legitimacy they need to strike a deal with Israel. Equally, an America that supports Palestinian statehood and is willing to take Israelis to account when they overstep or make unacceptable demands is also essential. We are seeking a win-win proposition. Finally, the blueprint for peace must consist of previous negotiations, such as the Taba negotiations of 2001, the Arab Peace Initiative of 2002, and proposals of the Ehud Olmert kind, which he was ready to make in 2008, as recently detailed in Condoleezza Rice's memoirs. We all know what a lasting peace should look like. So let us do something to implement that vision instead of returning once more to square one. The only losers in such a scenario would be the extremists in the area and Syria and Iraq, a pair of international pariahs who have worked tirelessly to undermine the peace process. Saudi Arabia recently played a leading role in isolating Syrian President Bashar al-Assad's brutal government by demanding an end to the killing of protesters and recalling the Saudi ambassador from Damascus. The impending fall of Mr. Assad's killing machine provides a rare strategic opportunity to weaken all extremists, including Iran. Without this vital ally, the radical leaders in Tehran will find it more difficult to foment discord in the Arab world. Today, there is a chance for the United States and Saudi Arabia to contain Iran's ambitious leadership and preventing them from destabilizing the region. But this opportunity will be squandered if the Obama administration's actions at the United Nations force a deepening split between our two countries. We hope that America will act justly with regard to Palestine, because a Middle East without trust, cooperation, and goodwill between Saudi Arabia and the United States will be harder for us all to navigate. If we do act jointly in favor of Palestinian statehood, and a resolution to a conflict that has been immensely costly in lives, diplomacy, and dollars, the benefits would be even greater. Regional peace, a new relationship between the United States and the Arab world, a more stable world economy, disempowered rogue regimes, and significant advances in the war on terror are only some of the gains we can look forward to. Saudi Arabia, ladies and gentlemen, stands for peace. But we cannot stand alone. In our effort to resolve the long-standing plight of the Palestinian people and to bring peace to a conflict that has exhausted our collective efforts for decades, we need the support of the international community, but especially that of the United States. American support for Palestinian statehood is crucial, and a veto at the United Nations will have profound negative consequences for the Middle East and the world as a whole. We hope that America will join us in transforming the Middle East by giving the Palestinians the state and home that they deserve. Let us pursue the victory of reason over violence, of ideas over raw emotions. Let us favor the rule of law over that of force, of honest negotiation over bloodshed, of right over might. And let us condemn those whose actions stand in glaring opposition to those standards. Let it be known that we will turn away from all who seek violent upheaval, but we will extend our hands to those who seek a true and lasting peace. And let us recall, ladies and gentlemen, the words penned by Thomas Jefferson in the American Declaration of Independence. We hope that these truths to be self-evident. We hold that these truths to be self-evident. That all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. As Americans sought these rights, fought for them, and achieved them, surely America will support the Palestinians in doing the same. And let us say a loud and emphatic yes to President Abbas of Palestine. Yes to justice, yes to statehood, yes to dignity, yes to peace, and yes to a home for the Palestinian people. Thank you.
Would you care to take questions, please?
You know, in Arabic we have a saying, it says, this is the chair of confession.
yes, the gentleman.
Your Royal Highness, my name is Sayyid Ali, and I'm a trained researcher, biochemist, and I retired from NIH 2 years ago. Thank you for your talk this afternoon. As you referred, and I haven't seen it, Condi Rice's autobiography states that Olmert was the former Prime Minister of Israel, virtually conceded almost all the things we are trying to achieve now, but it was turned down by the Palestinian Prime Minister, Mahmoud Abbas. Shouldn't in any future negotiations, countries like Saudi Arabia and other countries, Arab countries, should have a role that alone the Prime Minister of Palestine has the virtual veto on it, so others can also have an input whether the proposal is worthwhile and it should be accepted?
I mentioned in my presentation that once Palestinian state is established, it can enter on an equal basis into negotiations with an Israeli state, but that also Saudi Arabia, the Europeans, and other Arab governments should be engaged in the process. And let me just refer not just to the Olmert proposal, but also to the Taba proposals, and before that, to the Camp David proposals when Yasser Arafat met with Ehud Barak under President Clinton's leadership. Arafat Barak met without any consultation with the Arab world. And our ambassador at the time, Prince Bender, was here when he got a call from Yasser Arafat to tell him, Prince Bender, I need your help because we're stuck in this negotiation and President Clinton is pressuring me to agree to something which I simply had said before I came to the negotiations. I cannot agree to until I go back to my leadership. But he wants me to sign right now. And Prince Bender said, what are you talking about? Because we simply didn't know what was taking place. We knew that Arafat was here, but all the details of the negotiations were absent from our knowledge. And I think that was the basic reason for the breaking down of these negotiations at the time in Taba. In Camp David was because Arafat was brought by himself under great pressure from the United States. And there was no consultation with, at the time, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Jordan, and other Arab players who could have been helpful to Yasser Arafat and either giving him advice or some kind of shield from being accused of selling out, etc. And in the final analysis, and contrary to a previous agreement with President Clinton before he came to Washington, in which Arafat told President Clinton, I will come only if you say that if the negotiations break down, that there will be no blame assigned to any party. And sure enough, once the negotiations broke down, first thing President Clinton did was blame Yasser Arafat. So that was one aspect of the negotiations. The other was at Taba. And it, at that time, it was already January 2001, and a new American administration was coming in, and the Israeli administration at the time of Ehud Barak was going through an election, which they eventually lost. So nothing happened on that issue. And when Olmert presented his proposals to Mahmoud Abbas, it was 2008. And already Ehud Olmert was under indictment for a case of corruption in Israel. And it was clear he was not going to remain as Prime Minister of Israel. So in all of these cases, the situations where these proposals were being were being presented had difficulties to overcome them. And I would not blame Mahmoud Abbas for not accepting Olmert's proposition, because he was going to leave the premiership very, very soon afterwards, and nobody knew who was going to come and succeed, and whether they would also have the same commitment to the proposals that Olmert made. In all these circumstances, I think what I mentioned about engaging Saudi Arabia and other Arab countries and the Europeans is a necessity now, from two points. As I said in my presentation, the American administration is no longer trusted as a fair arbiter on this issue. So we need to have more of the international community involved in this. And the other point, of course, is for someone like President Obama, who's going into elections next year, and God knows when negotiations will start again, we'll need some kind of international forum to operate from. And it's not enough anymore for the quartet to be the arbiters there. They've already shown that they've left the ball in the hands of the Americans. Other people must be brought in to push the negotiations.
Professor Specific.
Let me just preface in what I said to you earlier. I apologize, I'll have to leave early because there's a directed meeting with the dean. With regard to what the ambassador has referred to, the Clinton-Abbas situation, a lot of people still aren't aware of what actually happened, and I suggest that you look up an article written by Rob Malley, who was a member of the National Security Council at that time. And I know that, I think that President Clinton sort of privately has acknowledged that there was an issue there, although I must say that shortly after he left office, he asked me and another fellow to run his first global meeting, at which it was amazing how often President Clinton was blaming the Palestinians and Abbas, you know, repeating that same story. But if you read Malley, who was a close associate of Clinton and is still on good terms, you'll see a completely different story than what we've had coming down. My question is, the position paper that you laid out is a terrific position paper. It makes ultimate sense. But if one looks at the reality of U.S. relations on the issue of Israel and Palestine under every president, and regrettably under the current president, whose speech in Cairo seemed to indicate that he was going to move beyond that, one is hard-pressed to say that President Obama has been significantly different or shown that he is willing to take that kind of stance. And given the realities of American politics domestically, as well, you know, the elections, the position of the Congress, etc., as well as, it seems, the president's disposition, as well as people will say, well, in a second term, if he gets a second term, things could be different. There are those of us who would argue that, no, what happens when you're a second-term president is that your party says to you, if they have a real problem with what you're saying, you know, don't commit suicide for us, we're up for re-election. So at the end of the day, I hate to sound so pessimistic, but how does one manage to get the leverage? I mean, the administration does not seem to be reading the fact that just how bad its credibility is overseas. And part of the problem that I would see is that there's a reluctance to think about a new paradigm, that we need a new paradigm. Just as the old paradigm proved a failure in dealing with, you know, with what ultimately expecting what the Arab Spring would do, there's a problem that we need a new paradigm with regard to Palestine and Israel. And the fact is, most of the players the president has who surround him and in office are people who continue to represent that old paradigm. So I ask you, Solomon, tell me, give me some hope.
Thanks for distinguishing me by comparing me to someone.
I've raised you to a prophetic level.
I know. Alas. you know, it is hence what I've been saying, that America will face a more negative view in the Arab world, and even staunch allies like Saudi Arabia will be recalibrating their positions on many issues, and I mentioned a few of them. You know, King Abdullah is a man of direct and frank discussion. And I'll just remind us, in 2001, with the new Bush administration, which simply said, don't bother us about the Middle East, we're going to look for other things to do. He sent a letter to President Bush, I think it was June or July 2001, in which he plainly stated that, Mr. Bush, if you want to continue to ignore us, that's your privilege, but allow us to disagree with you, and we are at a fork in the road. We can either go forward together, or we can each go our separate ways. And I wouldn't put it beyond King Abdullah to do something like that for Mr. Obama. In addition to what is happening on Palestine, Mr. Obama also disappointed, if you like, on the issue of where America stood when problems arose, particularly in Egypt. If you remember at that time, the flip-flopping that went on, Ambassador Wisner was sent to Egypt a few days before. Hillary Clinton quite publicly said, you know, we have full confidence in President Mubarak and so on. Wisner went with a message that was, as we understood from his own account of it, to express support to President Mubarak and to bolster him and tell him that America stands behind him. And in the middle of his voyage, there was a change of heart in Washington. Now, I'm not talking whether this is right or wrong. I'm just simply saying that how can you deal with someone who can change their mind so quickly on such important issues? Where is the reliability and the sense of assuredness that one would seek in going into very difficult situations? We're talking about terrorism. We're talking about potential nuclear proliferation in the area. We're talking about more conflict on the ground between Israel and the Palestinians, possibly dragging in others into the conflict. So all of these things are at stake here. And I simply don't know. And you're better qualified to judge what is happening in the White House and in Congress and so on than I am. But as I said, Yani, I wouldn't put it beyond the king to give notice to President Obama or whoever succeeds him, because we still don't know who's going to be president in 2012. And, you know, that things are going to be different. It's a different parameter. It's a different Arab world today by everybody's recognition. So you tell me, Professor. If I'm Solomon, you're David.
Okay. I think the lady there and then Mr. Shahid. Yes, go ahead.
Thank you so much. I'm Indira Lakshman from Bloomberg News. Thanks for speaking with us today. I wanted to get your comments on the vote by UNESCO today. By UNESCO, the UN Cultural Agency in Paris, to admit the Palestinians as a member. And this was something that got 107 votes in favor, so an overwhelming majority, but also 52 abstentions, which I think was a lot more than the Palestinians had hoped for. Can you comment on whether you think it shows some sort of a path to a higher status of the UN writ large, and also to the US condemning the move, and there even being threats of the US cutting off aid to UNESCO, which gives about 22% of the budget to UNESCO from the United States.
And I think things at the United Nations General Assembly will follow suit. inevitably, when the question comes to be voted on in the General Assembly, the Kingdom has expressed its support for Palestinian statehood, whether in UNESCO or any other organization, and will continue to express that support. How America deals with that is the whole contention of my presentation, that America must deal with it not in the normal and accepted form that it did before, but try to find a new way of accepting new realities in the Arab world. And UNESCO is one thing that to indicate. And I'm not worried about the numbers concerned. And even one state over the majority rule that they would have is enough, in my view, to have a just and a legitimate expression of world opinion than that. So it's up to the United States how it reacts.
And if the U.S. cuts off aid to UNESCO, do you think that would be more cutting off its nose to spite the space in terms of...
They've done that before. They've done that before. And UNESCO survived, and I think will continue to survive.
Yes, mine is really a follow-up on the need for a paradigm shift by Dr. Esposito. And the focus is on the promise of the Arab Spring. We talk about change sweeping the Arab world, and one consequence of that is increasing anti-Americanism and the erosion of American power, particularly in the region. But some people say there are certain dynamics even within the Arab Spring itself that indicate at least the potential for increased and more direct role, like, for example, NATO intervention in Libya. There are some people talking now about Libya becoming, in effect, a NATO protector. So there are different interpretations about the potential and the promise of the Arab Spring. How do you see that unfolding? Do you see the possibility of some sort of new formulation that will bring many Arab governments together that would constitute a real challenge to U.S. foreign policy and as a result some sort of change? Or more of the same, like each country, including Saudi Arabia, acting in its own or on the basis of its own interests?
If you notice in my presentation, I referred to the so-called Arab Spring. I'm one who objects to that really misconstrued and mm-hmm. very insulting description of what is happening in the Arab. I can't think of thousands of people being killed in civil strife and other troubles as indicating spring-like conditions. Mm-hmm. And so I would call it Arab troubles. And from there you can see where I'm heading, that we're still in a situation that is a work in progress. There are no set conditions yet in any of the Arab countries, including in Tunisia, that is just going through a process perhaps quicker than the others, where they had troubles to change to a new paradigm. But it will take a few years, in my view, before the dust settles and we get a clearer picture of how Egypt is going, etc., Syria, Yemen, Bahrain, Libya, and perhaps others. Have a very interesting, from my point of view, coming from Saudi Arabia, which is a monarchy, you have a very interesting experiment in Morocco in constitutional change and in setting the stage for a new paradigm for the relationship between the ruler and the ruled. So all of these things are still a work in progress. That doesn't mean that we sit on our backsides and do nothing. I think within the Gulf Cooperation Council, because of its own unique and different set of conditions, not just economic but political and otherwise, and as a reflection of what happened in Bahrain, I think there's going to be a much closer knit Gulf Cooperation Council than previously. Just for the fact that Bahrain was, if you like, a trouble spot that erupted, should have been expected, but alas, it wasn't, and required first aid quickly to help overcome the situation there. But it's not ended. Bahrain is also a work in progress that will take some time to overcome. And so the GCC countries, in seeing what happened there, I think, will want to have much closer, not just social and economic relations, but also political ties to overcome some of these difficulties that they may face in the future. How that reflects on the rest of the Arab world, we've seen that already on the issue of Libya, for example. When it first began, the problems there, it was the Gulf Cooperation Council countries that took the lead in going to the Arab League to promote for the kind of reaction worldwide through the Security Council to deal with the situation in Libya. And I think we'll see more of that. I wouldn't call it adventurous, but more forthcoming position on the part of the GCC, with Saudi Arabia, of course, playing an important role in pushing for that. On Syria, I think you'll find there as well the GCC taking the lead in pushing for developments in Syria. At the moment, I am not in the loop of knowing what government and other official circles are discussing in Syria, but I can see an inevitable course following from the withdrawal of GCC ambassadors from Syria to a call for a meeting in the Arab League a couple of weeks ago, and a subsequent formation of a committee to go and promote negotiations between the government. And if that fails, I can see more steps being taken at the Arab League level, prodded by the GCC for hopefully reaching an end to the killing that is taking place in Syria. And so I really don't know if I'm answering your question or not, but it is not an issue for me that I can see clearly that in 5 years' time this is what is going to happen. As I said in my presentation, the dynamics have changed. The rules of the game have changed. So we're still learning how to go forward on these issues. But I hope with better coordination and better core positions, let's say, within the GCC, you can affect the wider Arab context.
Thank you. We have our thank you very much, Your Highness, for coming for the thoughtful presentation. I'm usually an optimist, but seeing that the changes that are taking place in the Middle East are not reflected in what we would like to see in the administration's position, my question is, do leaders in the region, including Saudi Arabia, have like long-term approach to the problem? And specifically, I'm listening why I'm saying this, because we know that the change of leadership in the U.S. presidency does not mean a change in the U.S. foreign policy towards the region. It seems that no matter what happens, change will not affect the U.S. policy unless Congress is involved. And let me give you just a quick example. President Obama, in his speech in Cairo, and before that, and after, he and his executive demanded Israel to stop the
construction of settlements. They all fell on the field. In fact, Netanyahu came and he lobbied Congress to push back against the president. It seems that the first people who opposed President Obama was his own people, the Democratic leadership, let alone Republicans or the Tea Party. In other words, the Congress, the lobbying forces, are probably the intrinsic real forces for change. Congress is indifferent when it comes to change in the Middle East. So the executive branch, Obama and his colleagues, are incapable, because maybe they are unwilling, incapable of affecting change. So do Arab countries, of course we are involved in this as Muslim Americans, but they have a long-term plan to engage members of Congress and other forces of policy making in Washington, D.C. Because Obama cannot oppose Congress. I mean, this is how I feel about it, and I believe this is how it is.
Well, I would disagree with you on one basic fact. When Obama came to the White House, first of all, his first telephone call was to Mahmoud Abbas. His first television interview was with Al Arabian. And he apparently, in setting the stage for the reception of Netanyahu on his first visit to President Obama, did his homework in consulting with Congress, both sides. It was then, I think, still democratically controlled Congress. But nonetheless, he reached out to people like Congressman Cantor, who was at the time, I think, the minority leader in the House, and others of the Republicans. And Netanyahu came on his first trip, and he had the worst time in Washington he ever had. All of us remember that, with the body language and his visit to the Congress. Everybody told him, we can't disagree with our president, you have to do what our president wants. Where the change happened was after that, when Obama backed down and ceded the pressure. And of course, you can't blame the Congress for saying, well, why should we take the heat if Obama is not going to push this through? And that's when the whole thing began to unravel. Even people like Rahm Emanuel, not well known for his favoritism of Arabs, he took the position when he was the chief of staff of Obama to lobby in the Congress for the end to the settlement. And I am not aware of what made the change come about. But on his first visit, Netanyahu had the toughest time and didn't find the open doors that he would normally have in America. Subsequently, of course, there was a total retreat by Obama and the administration on all these issues. And of course, the Congress became the Congress. They want elections. They don't want anything else. So, and you're right, I think, in saying that perhaps congressmen and women have less concern about what happens in our part of the world. But I made a point to them. I remember when I was ambassador here, on my last visit to the Congress, and it was just after the 2006 elections when there was a sweep by the Democrats, if you remember. And I, among other Arab ambassadors, were invited to meet with new congressmen and women. There were about 40 of them in a hall in the Congress. And I made the following point to them. I said, ladies and gentlemen, please consider that every law, every resolution, every act that you undertake in this building today, because of the smallness of the world, because of the communications capabilities, all these things have direct bearing on my well-being in Riyadh. So keep in mind that one of these days I'm going to come to you and ask you to allow us to vote in your elections because what you do affects us. And when we have elections in Saudi Arabia, you can come and vote in them.
Gentlemen there, and then gentlemen in the back.
Yeah, yeah, it's me, Mike Springman. I'd like to follow on to Syed Awad's question. Israel is a small state. It's an illegitimate state. It's a terrorist state. Yet it completely controls American foreign policy towards the Arab world through its adherence to the United States, Zionazis, if you will. But there isn't enough money, there isn't enough organization to completely control Congress and the executive branch. How can you explain this in a way that I can tell my Arab friends what's going on here? Which I sure God don't know.
I think one of the main faults for that lies with us, the Arabs. And we have not operated the way that Israel has operated. There is a huge Arab community in America. It is not doing, I think, as much as they can. I think the Arab countries as well have been fractured and disunited. I remember being ambassador here, attending an Arab ambassador's meeting was one of the most difficult congregation to get together. There was always somebody absent, simply because we didn't give it the value that I think it deserves. And I think on both our sides as Arab countries from abroad, but also from the point of view of Arabs living in America, there has not been the concerted effort that the AIPAC people, for example, are very capable of doing. And look at their conferences and who attends and who doesn't, and where if somebody doesn't attend. It has become that kind of a ritual. We, on our side, have not played the game, simply. And I think that's one of our main faults, is that we've ceded this game to Israeli supporters.
Gentlemen in the back, and then...
Assalamu alaikum. Yes, assalamu alaikum. My name is Muhammad Ali. I'm with Somali American Peace Council. What would you advise us to, as Muslim Americans, to have an influence in the foreign policy of the United States, not only for Palestine, which unfortunately our brother suffered over 60 years, but Somalia and other Muslim countries? There's always decided our foreign policy. In our case, with Ethiopia, the army invaded a proxy war with the last administration, and the country is suffering. And our brothers, and I'm glad that you are come up with this wonderful presentation. They suffered over 60 years. So, and I hope things with the UNESCO, the way it started, will continue success, and they will have their freedom. What would you advise as a Muslim Americans, how can we have an influence? Our governments here, we have rights, and we have freedom of speech that we have in this country that we can take benefit of it. And we're not afraid that somebody's going to come up to you to snatch you, because it's free we have at least. So what would you advise us? How can we influence our government here to be neutral for the Muslim world?
It's, as I mentioned before, my previous answer, I think what Muslims and Arabs have to do in the United States is to emulate others. Learn from the Zionist lobby. Learn from the Italian lobby. Learn from the Greek lobby. There are so many lobbies here. And they get their way because they operate together and they have specific programs and they pursue them, and in the end everybody is beholden to these lobbies. Now, in terms of numbers, the Arab Muslim community here is quite sizable and can, I think, affect policymakers in Congress particularly, but also in the administration. Take advantage of that. You say you have advantages, and you do. Simply see what the others are doing. I remember, as ambassador here, attending an ADC conference. Maybe some members of the ADC are here. And which it was a fundraising conference for the ADC. This is the Anti-Discrimination Committee, I think. Headed by Mary Rose Oker, a wonderful lady, ex-congresswoman, etc., and initially founded by James Eversk. They were trying to raise money for their organization, and they must have had the biggest ballroom in Washington, where literally, I think, more than a couple of thousand people were dining, and they had someone like Omar al-Sharif as MC, a wonderful MC with lots of sense of humor, trying to raise money. Now, a week before that, it was, I think, IPAC that had a similar function. And the week before that, it was the Italian community that had a similar function. The Italians, I think, at the time, raised something like $50 million from their convention. And the IPAC people, I think, if I'm not mistaken, something like $150 million. You know how much they raised that night? $1.5 million. And that's the difference. Now, I know that Arabs and Muslims in America do well financially. You know, they don't talk about it, but they do. But, you know, they simply haven't galvanized their resources, whether human or financial, to do what the Israelis do and what the Italians, what the Greeks, what the Indians, etc.
Gentlemen.
Sir, the United
May
States...
May I ask who you are, sir?
I'm Herbert Schmitz with the International Student House. The United States has been lobbying to get enough votes in the Security Council to avoid having to veto. Can you tell us, and they're one vote short, I understand. Can you tell us who the, I believe, seven or eight nations are who have already agreed to vote against the Palestinian?
I don't know. I am not.
How can we find out?
Well, ask the Palestinian representative. He should be in Washington. I'm sure he can give you a better accounting of that. And just imagine if that effort went the other way. Instead of the United States trying to push countries not to vote for Palestine, if they pushed for those countries to vote for Palestine, what a wonderful result of that would be for the rest of us. I wouldn't have to give speeches anymore.
But the only other comment I would have is you're almost preaching to the choir here.
Okay.
I wish Bloomberg and others would spread this word throughout the United States, because there is an ignorance on the part of most American newspaper readers, and I read 2 or 3 newspapers a day. It's appalling how little of this information is being spread in the United States.
Yes, the young man there, and then the lady in the back.
Your Royal Highness, you briefly touched on in your
May
presentation.
May I ask who you are?
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Omid Townsend. I was a student here last year at Georgetown. I'm also the intelligence officer now at the Army. So my question is, you touched on a little bit about what Iran's strategic interest is in the region and how these interests kind of don't correlate with the broader international goals of establishing a two-state solution. Can you elaborate on that a little bit and what implications that has for Saudi-Iranian relations if there was peace to be established, and how that could affect Iranian relations?
Their position is quite clear. They would like to see, and I hope there are people who can correct me here, because I may have misread what they say. They say that they would like to see one Palestine that would have Jews and Christians and Muslims together, and that they would like to see that put to a referendum in the Israel and in the occupied territories, and leave it to the people of those of Israel and the occupied territories to decide on whether they would accept that or not. So they're not for a two-state solution. That they're clear about, which is something that the rest of us are for. There is one divergence there. But equally, I think, in terms of Iran, I've described Iran as a paper tiger with steel claws. And because I think as a government a structure, a state structure, it's pretty dysfunctional, with all the differences they have between the president and the religious leader and revolutionary guard, etc. There are just too many compartmentalized groups in Iran that have too much. I don't know if you read a book many years ago called the Peter Principle. Any of you read that? Mm-hmm. It describes the lateral arabesque. When someone reaches his level of inefficiency, they sort of bump him aside or her and give him the lateral arabesque. And I think a lot of that happens in Iran, overburdened with huge bureaucracy and terrible economic management, etc. But it has these steel claws that it can use to advance its positions, not just in the Arab world, but I think within the world community. When the late Ayatollah Khomeini came to power, one of the first actions that the Iranian government took was to establish what it called the Hezbollah. They had the Hezbollah in Lebanon, they had the Hezbollah in the Hejaz, they had the Hezbollah in Turkey, Hezbollah in Pakistan, etc., etc. In practically all Muslim countries, they established this entity. Now, in many places, they've gone dormant and haven't operated at all. But in Lebanon, it was very active. In Turkey, in the 80s and early 90s, it was very active. In Pakistan, it was very active, and I think it still is active in Pakistan. And in Bahrain, it is also active. So those are the what I would call the steel claws that Iran uses to advance its agenda. Among the Palestinian groups, if you remember, in the 80s, when Hamas began to establish itself, it was the only divergent group from Fatah and the established PLO groupings under Yasser Arafat at the time, Habash and Hawatma and so on. And Hamas was the only independent one. But when Khomeini came to power, one of the first acts he did in Palestine was to establish what was called the Islamic Jihad in Palestine, with financing from Iran and so on. And they're still operating. And within Gaza particularly, they have strong representation. So it is these these entities that Iran uses to extend its influence in the Arab and Muslim world. And they use them. I'm sure they start from a position that this is in our interest and we would like to have allies in these places. And we use them to further our aims. But in some cases, as our foreign minister said once when he was addressing the ex-Iranian foreign minister Muttaqi on a visit to Riyadh 3 years ago, he in a press conference, he said, "I wish that we want to have cooperation with Iran, but Iran must cooperate with us through official channels and not through the unofficial entities that they have," meaning Hezbollah and at that time. Now Hezbollah is part of the government, of course, in Lebanon, but in Islamic Jihad in Palestine, etc.
But they go so far as to try to assassinate an ambassador.
Excuse me, don't just to start. You know, this is not a press interview. I'm sorry to have to stop.
I just was building on this question about the assassination.
You have to wait for your turn.
Thank you.
The young woman in the back is.
Hi, my name is Celeste Holmes. I'm a graduate student here in Muslim Christian relations. And to me, one of the main problems is the Israeli lobby coupled with the religious right in this country, Pastor Hagee, Pat Robertson, because of the rapture and the end times, all giving uncritical support to Israel. So as the gentleman over there alluded to, doesn't matter who's in the Congress or the president, they're all being held hostage by these groups. And given that, you said Saudi Arabia will have to recalculate some of their positions. The announcement yesterday that since the U.S. can't get the immunity from Iraq, that we're being booted out, but now we're building up our presence in the Gulf and Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, and Bahrain. would that be one of the decisions that you, that the Saudis might examine of taking our troops out if you don't see that we're doing what needs to be done?
Nothing is being built in Saudi Arabia, because the only American presence we have in Saudi Arabia is a training mission. There are no American troops stationed in Saudi Arabia, combat troops. There's a training mission. And that's been the case since 2003, when America invaded Iraq and the air base that was providing landing and support for American Air Force units that were overseeing the no-fly zone in Iraq as a result of the Gulf War back in 1991 ended when America invaded Iraq. So there are no American combat troops in the kingdom whatsoever. In Bahrain, of course, they have treaty obligations, and in Kuwait as well, and I think also in the UAE and in Qatar. So they may have increased their troop deployment in those countries.
The gentleman just behind, yes.
Stanley Kober, the Georgetown alum. I'd like to pursue this Iran angle. Because I'm thinking, if not the United States, then who? I mean, if you're not going to ally with the United States against Iran, what are the other options? Russia is no longer a superpower, can't really project power. China's far away, building up its power, is still regional. Just in practical terms, I'm left with Turkey, which now has apparently deteriorating relations with Iran, and geographically, militarily, could provide something. But I'm wondering if we could put some more flesh on the bones here. What would be Saudi Arabia's options?
Well, yeah, Saudi Arabia, as you said, has options in Turkey. As I told you, within the GCC, the countries are coming more closely together. We're not seeking a confrontation with Iran. We're simply telling the Iranians to back off. Now, whether it is in Bahrain or in Iraq or in Palestine or in Lebanon or in Syria, wherever, or in Yemen, wherever they have been actively engaged in one form or another in incitement and in upheaval. The United States, as I mentioned here, they're the ones who have to make the difficult choices, because we've dealt with difficult situations with Iran, even under Khomeini, to the point where we broke relations with Iran for many years at that time, and so. It is not an issue of either the United States or chaos. No. The kingdom will maintain a robust and hopefully effective defensive policy. We'll buy weapons from America and continue to buy weapons from America and get training from the military mission in Saudi Arabia. If America sees it's in its interest to withdraw that training mission, we will engage with others to provide us with such expertise, because we don't believe that we know all the answers. And so the kingdom is not in a situation of either or when it comes to doing what I said, realigning our policy in the area. But I think it is America that is now in a situation where there more and more for them it's going to be either or. Let me give you an example. I remember back in 77 or rather 79, President Carter was president. The Iranian Revolution had taken place. American embassy was taken hostage, etc. So relations between America and Iran were at a minimum level. And to show his support for Saudi Arabia at the time, because the Iranians had already begun a propaganda campaign against the kingdom, etc. President Carter decided to send a squadron of F-15 aircraft to the kingdom. Now, the kingdom very, I think, astutely said, Ahlan wa sahlan, welcome. But is it just going to come like that? Or what are the details of that? And he said, yes, they will come and they will be based in Dahran and so on. And we said, well, is it all right if we could base them in Tabuk, up near the Israeli border? And President Carter said no. Why? He said, well, the enemy is here in the east. And we said, well, maybe so for the moment, but we have enemy here in the northwest. We'd like to have the aircraft based there. And the final analysis they made simply a stopover trip and so on. And it was that's the kind of negotiations that we have with America, where we tell them exactly what we want and we expect them to reciprocate in kind. Now, just as an aside, Yanni, the aircraft, when they ended up in Dahran, we found out that they had no ammunition. So it was just a symbolic gesture at the time that the president wanted to use to show that America was serious about the hijacking of the American embassy and so on. And who could blame him? But it is something that you know, the kingdom will be more inclined to be very outright and very straightforward and very demanding in terms of all the information that comes with any step taken by the United States in our relationship either with Iran or with any other country. And one thing about Iran, I think I mentioned this in many of my presentations, which is the need for a zone free of weapons of mass destruction in the area. This is where the kingdom, the Arab League, has gone. And last year at the review conference of the Non-Proliferation Treaty in New York, the conferees all agreed to establish a zone, and they set 2012 as the year when there will be a conference held at the United Nations to see how this zone will be set up. What I've been promoting as an individual, but I think I can get others to agree to it, is that for the zone to succeed, first of all, it must have all the countries in the area included, not just Iran and Saudi Arabia and Egypt and Iraq and so on, but also Turkey and Israel. And secondly, it must have a sanctions regime and a rewards regime for the countries that join or not join. The rewards being technical and economic aid to the countries that join to develop civilian peaceful uses of energy from nuclear sources, but also a nuclear security umbrella for the members of the of the zone, guaranteed by the five permanent members of the Security Council. And the sanctions regime will have to have not just diplomatic and economic sanction against any country that stays out of the regime, out of the zone, but also a military option to prevent any country from developing nuclear weapons in the area or weapons of mass destruction in the area. Also guaranteed by the five permanent members of the Security Council. So that, I think, when it comes to Iran, will show how serious the rest of the world community is, as well as Israel. One of the ironies in all of this, of course, which not many people know about, is that in 1974, Egypt and Iran at the time, under the Shah, were the ones who presented the idea of a zone free of nuclear weapons to the United Nations at that time. And Iran publicly still says that it agrees to that proposition. So putting bone and flesh on this proposition, I think, will allow us not only to draw Iran in, but also hopefully to bring Israel in as well.
Okay, we have a question for one last thing, but I'm also abuse the privilege of the chair. Your Highness, I think you are absolutely right in saying this, and as someone that was worked 5 years in the CCD when I was in Geneva and the first nuclear review conference. How about Pakistan? Because Pakistan also has to come to this, and also India, particularly from Iran's perspective, because Pakistan is sometimes is a, you know, a security threat to Iran, including through support of groups like Jundullah and others who have committed terrorist acts in the Iranian Zahedan province. And so if you would also address this dimension of security threats to Iran a little bit, because it's not just one-sided, I would appreciate it. And then the gentleman has the last word, and after that we will close. Please.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Muhammad Al-Qayyid. I am a senior analyst for the Middle East. I just from the Georgetown University.
Georgetown University?
Yes. And my question is, given the influence of Saudi Arabia over all the Middle East, I think, could Your Highness tell us how could Saudi Arabia influence establishing the elements of finding a state in the areas already now governed by the Palestinians, by bridging the differences between them and giving assurances, not to Israel only, that they can live in peace in a state near Palestinians, but the region and the whole world. Thank you, Palestine.
The kingdom has tried in the past, as you know, to bring Hamas and Fatah together, and continues to support the Egyptian efforts, which are still operating. There was an agreement signed, I think, 3 months ago in Cairo by Mahmoud Abbas and Khalid Mishal, but putting flesh to the bones on that agreement is still a work in progress. And I think it is, on the part of the Palestinians, a shameful issue that they should still be in this situation where Hamas and Fatah are at loggerheads. It is unacceptable and totally without reason. They should get over it. For God's sake, and if Hamas can reach an agreement with Israel on the exchange of Shalit and receive 1,000 and some Palestinian, I'm sure they can find things to agree about with Mahmoud Abbas. And, you know, the kingdom will do what is necessary. But you say we have influence. Maybe we do, but not to the extent where we say you do it and they do it. So it takes diplomacy and other means to convince them to do that. And let me just say about Iran, and I think you're
and
right,
Pakistan.
Professor.
Pakistan.
Pakistan. But also Pakistan, Iran's security concerns. Iran is a country of history and culture and contribution to civilization that, unfortunately, in today's world, is not given recognition to. When people, I don't know, I have not attended Georgetown courses on Iran, but in none of the courses I've attended in the past as a student and now as a visiting teacher here.
Because Iranians are worse than the Arabs. They don't put up the money.
No, it's not just the money. Not just the money, but and I think that I don't see mention. You know, people talk about Greek civilization, about Roman civilization, about Arab civilization, Muslim, about Chinese, about Pharaonic Egypt, you name it. Nobody mentions Darius or Cyrus or the great contributions in science and mathematics and chess, for God's sake, was invented by the Iranians. it's a wonderful game, and I'm sure some of you have tried. But, you know, things like that, and I think that is, it is unfair. Maybe the Iranians have been lacking in promoting this thing, but it gives, I think, Iranians a sense that they're, first of all, that they're being taken for granted, and secondly, that they're not given their due weight that they deserve. And if you remember, during the Shah's time, his celebration of Persian history and culture at Persepolis and so on went to an extreme, and maybe that led to the revolution, but nonetheless, yeah, there was this feeling. And I think under Khomeini as well, there is that sense that, you know, Iranian prestige should be pushed forward, but under a Muslim complexion, yeah, particularly the Shia sect. So this, I think, when we deal with Iran, we have to keep in mind that this is a reality, that Iranians come at us from that perspective, and we should respect that. And as far as Pakistan is concerned, I think India and Pakistan should be brought into a zone free of weapons of mass destruction between themselves. Don't push them into the Middle East, because if you push them into the Middle East, it's not going to work. But if it works in the Middle East, I think it can work between India. In Latin America, they have zones free of weapons of mass destruction between the Latin American countries and so on. And in other places, I think they have. So definitely there is a need for such a zone in Pakistan.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you.